I've had the fortune to have a lot of positions where you can influence the politics of an area. So I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about the politics of watershed health.
I think that when you talk about the politics of watershed health, you really need to think about how we as a society and our institutions have tried to address healthy watersheds. And I think the tradition, starting with really the progressive movement and the founding of the Forest Service at the turn of the last century, was really founded on and grew on a notion of responsibility for water and watersheds as one of the founding missions of the Forest Service. And at that time, the way we approached the politics of watershed health, which is what I learned when I was in graduate school studying natural resource policy, was that you had people who were experts, foresters, aquatic ecologists, and if federal agencies and state agencies hired the experts, then the experts would figure out what the right thing to do was, and they'd do it. And our notion of what's the role of the public in that was that the big progressive advancement was the Administrative Procedures Act in the 1950s, where you'd tell the public. The innovation was you wouldn't just do it institutionally, you'd actually tell the public what you were going to do. They'd have a chance to comment, and then you'd go ahead and do it. And I think what we have discovered and what my experience has been working on watershed health issues for much of my career is that it became abundantly clear that the public wasn't happy with deferring to that progressive conservation notion of experts that could decide and determine what the public interest was and then carry it out both on public lands and private lands through command and control regulatory systems, whether it's the Forest Practices Act or the Clean Water Act or the Endangered Species Act. So through particularly the 70s, the 80s, into the 90s, there was the growth of the environmental movement, but there were also the growth of wise use movement, of trade associations, of non-governmental organizations that really became engaged in what I spent most of my career dealing with, which was interest group pluralism, where the assumption was that these warring parties, through negotiated rulemaking, through the legislative process, that everybody could be represented by an interest group, and all the different perspectives could be and would be represented, and that somehow through this clash of ideas of interest group pluralism, we would then come up with a determination of what the public interest was. And I think that in the last probably 10 to 15 years, what's become apparent to, I think, many of us is that the interest group pluralism system is broken down, particularly because, in my opinion, of money and politics. And anyone would be hard-pressed to say that that clash of interest groups is developing the public interest or defining the public interest. And instead, what we've had, I think, particularly at the federal level and the state level across the country, is gridlock and the status quo. But what's very exciting is that somewhat in response to that gridlock and response to the real public interest in watershed health and the health of the land and the health of communities, we've had the growth of place-based collaborative efforts where people come together in communities to address issues of watershed health and to take action to make things happen. And I think the challenge for us today is how do we match up those voluntary, place-based, collaborative efforts? How do we fit the vision and dreams of those communities into the existing state and federal traditional bureaucratic regulatory processes? And that's the challenge I see moving forward. But it's very much a change from the experts of the progressive era to interest group pluralism to a new type of place-based collaborative governance.
Is your sense that the bureaucracies, the agencies, are willing to accept the visions of these place-based groups?
I think it depends upon what level you're talking. The willingness of the bureaucracies to accept the visions of the cooperative groups is going to depend a lot upon who you're talking to within the bureaucracy and what level of the bureaucracy in the existing political establishment are you talking about. I think that many of the national interest groups find place-based collaborative processes very threatening and are very unwilling to embrace the visions that come out of the collaborative processes. Certainly that's what you found with the National Environmental Organizations and the Quincy Library Group in Northern California. But you find that with, I think you can see that same kind of pushback with some of the elected political leaders in Congress or in state legislators. I find the strongest pushback is from the national interest groups who don't want to move away from the interest group pluralism model and feel that if it's place-based and local, how can they engage? And I think that's another major challenge that the collaborative movement is going to have to address. But what I find is that some of the people that are the most engaged in and the most effective at the place-based collaborative processes are actually the people working on the ground for the federal and state agencies who see that while they might not be able to get something done in Washington, D.C., or they might not be able to get something done at the regional office, or they might not be able to get something done in the state capitol, they really find that their skills, their agency resources can make a real difference in leveraging and engaging the power of the community on the local basis to do very exciting things. So I think the field level folks in the bureaucracies are quite engaged at other levels of the political process and the bureaucracies. Sometimes the engagement breaks down.
I think that's very true, yeah. What's interesting about that perspective is that I don't think our field-based people are trained to do that. In our universities, in our natural resource disciplines, there's a lot of coursework that needs to occur, and often those relationships, the ideas of communicating, are not really part of the curriculum. And so what you're really looking at is individuals' skills. How do you get that into your workforce? How do you nurture it in your workforce?
The challenge of transforming the education of environmental professionals or natural resource professionals is huge. And I think that for natural resource professionals to use their scientific knowledge and understanding and insights, their management skills successfully, I think throughout society today we recognize that it takes a whole lot more than technical expertise. And one of the wonderful things about what happens here on the H.J. Andrews through the long-term ecological reflections program is that there are people learning to learn, learning to learn, learning to work together as teams on an interdisciplinary basis. And so with our reflections over the last couple of days are a very good example of that, where we have health professionals who have introduced insights and vocabulary from bioethics that are pretty straightforward to them, but those of us on the natural resource side have never been exposed to them. And so we learn completely new ways of thinking from bioethicists working in the healthcare hospital environment or hospice environment that help us think about what does watershed health mean. And I think that one of the things that faces the university today, and I work in a university, is how do we, from the time people are freshmen through their graduate education, how do we teach them the skills of interdisciplinary scholarship? How do we teach them the skills of collaboration and working in interdisciplinary teams? Because I think that scholarship related to innovation, discovery, shows almost across the board that radical innovation happens through interdisciplinary thinking. And most of the new scientific insights are happening not because a biochemist is sitting in his or her lab working on biochemistry problems, or an aquatic ecologist is out doing stream studies with other aquatic ecologists. The really breakthrough insights and new understandings come when you have interdisciplinary teams collaboratively working together. And that requires new communication skills. And then I think those kinds of communication skills that come through working in teams translate pretty readily into working in communities. So that's the kind of approach that I think we need to take as we change not only undergraduate and graduate education, but as we train lifelong learners in all of our institutions.